Distinguished Chairperson, Senior Anesthesiologist, my dear friends and colleagues. Good evening all and a warm welcome to Rajagiri Hospital. This is a wonderful picture. It's taken for some other reason. But what I find in this, the kid who is pretending to drive this vehicle or things like he's the owner of the vehicle should understand there are two more persons, our kids, at the bottom who is forming the base or the engine for their dream vehicle. So most of the successful stories behind any surgical procedure, there is an anesthesiologist. So I believe in teamwork. To start with this, in 1750, anatomist John Hunter colorfully described surgery as the humiliating spectacle of futility of science and the surgeon as the savage armed with a knife. Thank God we are in the anesthetic era. Just think, there is no anesthesia, no painkillers. Our situations are very bad. Even nobody would have been accepting any surgery, even a minor one. From C-sections performed to help delivery a baby or organ transplant and cosmetic surgery, surgeries are certainly life-saving marvels in this day and age. However, surgeries used to be the last resort, characterized by great risk. As a surgeon, from the beginning, we are facing three obstacles: the bleeding, pain, and infections. The pain of patient as well as the surgeon. So pain was believed to be vital to keep the patient alive. Chinese and Indian doctors used hallucinogenic drugs like marijuana and hashish. Some of the Egyptian surgeons used to chew cocoa leaves and spit it into the wound of the victim to get relieved of pain. Even doctors used techniques to numb limbs, including compression to cut off blood flow and sensation. Some surgeons were even known to straight knock up the patient unconscious with a hit on the head or by strangulation. We see in movies now. Pediatric anesthesia in Rajagiri Hospital has evolved from its infancy and now it is stabilized with our excellent team of anesthetists headed by Dr. Annie. So, I start my topic with a thank to Dr. Bala Venkat, who has almost simplified my talk and given a brief introduction about what I was thinking. Thank you, sir. Children are most susceptible to fear, anxiety and stress due to their limited cognitive capabilities and dependency. The preoperative period is a stressful event for the majority of the individuals undergoing surgery, even adults. Effective pre-anesthetic medication in children helps to allay apprehension regarding the anesthesia and the surgery because they are going to get separated from the parents and lessen the trauma, separation from the family, facilitate the induction of general anesthesia and a quick post-operative recovery. This is the most important art, getting close to the kids. Somebody has to run a puppet show, sing, dance, whatever it may be, to make the child comfortable and gain their confidence. So for this, the pre-anesthetic medications are helpful. I don't know which is the ideal pre-anesthetic medication, but it is defined like should be available in a preparation that is readily accepted by the children, have a rapid onset, provide anxiolysis and mild sedative effect, be free of side effects, provide a rapid recovery and return to alertness postoperatively. I don't know anything is available like this or not. You people might be the best ones. So, 75 patients in an age group of 2 to 6 years of either sex of American Society of Anesthesiology, physical status class 1 and 2 admitted in a hospital in Amritsar. They were divided into 3 groups, 25 each number. The first group was given an intranasal fentanyl. The second group was given an intranasal midazolam. The third group was given intranasal dexmedetomidine. And they concluded that the group which was given intranasal fentanyl had a rapid onset of action, deeper sedation and a easy postoperative recovery. This is another study, included 60 healthy male and female children aged 2 to 6 years who are undergoing an elective surgery. Again, the subjects were divided into 2 groups. Group 1, 30 children receiving oral midazolam, and group 2, 30 children receiving nasal midazolam spray. On the basis of the study, they concluded that midazolam nasal spray was shown to have improved sedative scores and ease of induction and a recovery scores. So the point to emphasize is that we can start using a safer and an effective pre-anesthetic medication. Is anesthesia a concern? Yes. Not even for children, for everybody. I don't know how many of you are facing this question, but in and out every day I am facing this question by the parents that is anesthesia safe for my child? Is anesthesia required for my child to undergo any procedure? What should we say, yes or no? Definitely we should say yes. So without anesthesia we cannot do that. But studies have shown that most susceptible period to be believed, the period of maximal synaptogenesis, is less than 3 years. So during this vulnerable period, there is an evidence that exposure to anesthetic agents can lead to neurotoxicity at the cellular level and as well as the causes functional deficit. So they prove that the vulnerable age is less than 3 years. These are some of the studies done on non-human primates and rodents on some of the anesthetic agents like ketamine, isoflurane, sevoflurane, propofol and some combined agents. The cellular effects were neuroptosis, neurodegeneration, neuroinflammation, and there is defects in neurogenesis, growth cone polarization, cytoarchitecture and defect in dendritic density. And some behavioral changes like learning, spatial memory, motor activity, attention and social behavior. Then what happened? In December 2016, the FDA issued the warning. Repeated lengthy use of general anesthetic and sedation drugs during the surgery in children younger than 3 years and in pregnant women during their third trimester may affect the development of child's brain. So in response to this, the American Society of Anesthesiologists, the Society of Pediatric Anesthesia Committee has issued a statement based on this 3 studies, an anesthesia compared to spinal anesthesia gas study and a pediatric anesthesia neurodevelopment assessment panda study and a Mayo anesthesia safety in kids mask study, said that single brief anesthetic exposure does not appear to be associated with any neurodevelopmental deficit. We are safe. but the case is less clear with repeated exposure and exposure of long duration. Now again we are back to square one. A single exposure have not been associated with the detectable neurodevelopment effects, but they fail to define what is that brief. In the case of whether to proceed with an elective surgical procedure, the risk and the benefit in each case must be weighed carefully. And there are evidence reassuring as that the study is still going on and we are yet to answer the parents the question like I asked, is anesthesia safe? So can we cut down on the duration of anesthesia? It's not in your hands, it's in our hands. So the concept came as damage control surgery. What is damage control surgery? It's for example, to say a child or a patient with a blunt injury abdomen with a liver laceration. You take the child for a laparotomy, do the liver packing, look for any other bleeding and just come out. That is, just stabilize it and come out. Shorter duration of anesthesia, shorter duration of systemic inflammatory response, everything. Now, as a pediatric anesthetist, you should be aware of this issue also, and unplanned anesthesia related admissions. A 6-year audit was conducted. A total of 47% of these admissions were related to airway problems, and 68% of the children requiring admissions were aged less than 5 years. Around 50,000 procedures were performed, resulting in 319 unplanned admissions to high dependency unit and pediatric intensive care unit. A rate of 0.6% of these, 34% were related to complications of anesthesia. Around 10,000 children underwent day case surgery, of whom 2.2% experienced unplanned hospital admissions. Upon that, again 60% were related to anesthesia. So, is there any other out of harm's way? I am sure that I am not aware of the regional anesthesia conferences going on the next year. But somehow I had a thought in my back of my mind and made this. So you might be listening or experiencing more about this the coming year, but I'll give a simple introduction on this. So for several years, most pediatric procedures were performed solely under general anesthesia. Since the mid-1980s, there has been a resurgence in the interest in regional anesthesia for pediatric procedures. Today, regional anesthesia has become a fundamental component of modern pediatric anesthesia practice. The development of appropriate size equipment has improved the safety and efficacy. A review of pediatric pain management would be incomplete without considering the advances in the latest innovative approaches of neuraxial and peripheral nerve blocks. Langer and colleagues studied on 99 children who underwent inguinal hernia repair, where intraoperative ilioinguinal and iliohypogastric nerve injections with bupivacaine were given, and the results were excellent. The post-operative pain was less, early recovery, perioperative stress levels were low, and most important is the respiratory depression due to opioids were low. It's now acknowledged and generally accepted that the performance of neuraxial and peripheral nerve blocks in children under general anesthesia are safe. A large multi-center prospective study including 24,000 procedures revealed that only 23 adverse events. To provide high quality anesthesia to pediatric patients, and placement of regional blocks in carefully selected instances should be considered whenever it is possible. This is the common procedure we do in and out. A single shot caudal epidural block remains the cornerstone of postoperative regional anesthesia in children, offering a reliable and an effective block for patient undergoing procedures involving the lower abdomen and extremities. According to the study by Schuffer and colleagues, anesthesiology residents first exposed to caudal blocks were able to achieve a high success rate after performing the techniques almost day when they complete some 32 blocks, and the results was comparable to that of the staff anesthesiologist. The attractiveness of this technique lies in the simplicity of the procedure and a high success rate. Adjuncts to the caudal block in children, to add or not, again I leave it back to you. You are the people who can judge on that one. I have seen anesthesiologist adding clonidine, but I am not sure about morphine, fentanyl, ketamine, midazolam and neostigmine. Continuous epidural analgesia. This is where most of the anesthetists find they are uncomfortable. Although the feasibility of placing epidural catheters directly in the thoracic space has been demonstrated, still there is a lack in these procedures. So instead preferring to thread the catheter from the caudal to the thoracic or the lumbar epidural space. I understand that there is a disadvantage to the procedure, is the risk of infection because of repeated soiling, but that can be prevented by tunneling. That is described by Vivek and colleagues, subcutaneous tunneling of these catheters. A word about spinal anesthesia. It is one of the oldest technique for providing pain relief for surgery below the umbilicus or the lower extremities. It was first described by Ruther Williamson in 1915 in Madras. He used stobane, and further in 1933 it was discarded. Then they started using spinocaine and percaine, but I don't know now how many of them are using that. But the advantage of this spinal anesthesia is most important in a preterm. So the most postoperative studies show approximately 20 to 30% of otherwise healthy former preterm infant having an hernia repair under general anesthesia have an apneic spells. So in several small studies, infant spinal anesthesia has been associated with a lower incidence of hypotension, bradycardia and postoperative apnea compared to general anesthesia. Again, here is another area where there is lack of interest. So, use of ultrasound in the peripheral nerve blocks for the extremities are very good. Just what we have to do is introduce the anesthetist to the basic concept about ultrasound. That's what we have to do. That's it. Then they'll catch it up. The last word about pain call. We cannot say it is a pain and palliative as in case of adults, because I don't say any palliative, word palliative in a pediatric patient. It's a pain, what they feel and experience is for everybody, even the parents, even the doctor who is going for the next day morning rounds. So since the beginning of the 21st century, there has been a groundswell of interest in effective pain management for children. It's important to appreciate the psychological and neurodevelopment impact of unrelieved pain of our smallest patient. The understanding about the ontogeny of pain pathway in the developing brain and its importance of neural plasticity. This has led the researchers to improve the management of perioperative pain. At the bedside, clinicians have experienced the use of patient control analgesia, PCA. Whether administered by the patient or proxy, the development and cognitive behavioral approach by may significantly contribute to the management of anxiety, depression and pain. The necessity for being able to measure the pain and follow its course in the children has led to a great deal in interest. Some of the other routes, the simplest of these is the international application of the lipid-soluble opioids. The advantages are like no need for intravenous access, easily available, and we can use it for burns dressing. And some of the agents like fentanyl, L-fentanyl, sulfentanyl, and butyrophenols. Last is, these are some of the high-risk cases which we have managed here in Rajagiri Hospital with the help of our experienced and an excellent anesthetic team. 4 cases of necrotizing enterocolitis. One was 450 gram. The second one was an 800 grams baby. 2 cases of congenital diaphragmatic hernias. 2 cases of extraepiphyseal pericardial complex. 2 cases of tracheoesophageal fistula. I think one Dr. Madhu has explained. The second one had a triple atresia. Esophageal atresia, duodenal, and an anal atresia. The congenital cardiac problem, 1 case of anorectal malformation, 2 cases of VS assisted thoracoscopic surgery which required a 1 lung ventilation, and 1 case of a suspect biliary atresia. So here I conclude, anesthesia for children begins with an age appropriate assessment, a sound knowledge of pharmacology and developmental physiology, initiating analgesia before the surgical stimulus, and using a multimodal approach like opioids and others. Our greatest challenge as pediatric specialists is not only to advance the practice with more technically sophisticated gadgets, but also to use an appropriate, safe and effective pre-anesthesia and an anesthetic medication. Pre-anesthesia checkup, please spare some time with the child and the bystanders. Explain them about the basics of anesthesia and the importance of pediatric anesthesia. Effective pre-anesthetic medication in children helps to allay apprehension and minimize the number of anesthesia exposure. I am saying this to myself and the surgeons. Today, regional anesthesia has become the fundamental component of most modern pediatric anesthesia practices. Effective pain management. It's most important. We have to see smiling faces during the next post-operative day rounds, and we all should ensure that our kids should have an uneventful recovery. I'm finishing by saying, as a pediatric anesthetist, you should say that in every breath, in every beat, and in every second, we are there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kabir. Anesthesiology conference and know so much of like blocks, and you have learned a lot about it's good that you feel that this is a teamwork, and definitely to have good outcomes you need to have work as a team, and surgeon's role starts before the anesthesiologist comes into the picture. Like the patient first comes to you, and it's you are explaining the initial part, and it's good to know that. Thank you so much.
I thank organizers.